purpose of Freethought Forum is to be vigilant to the encroachment of religion into government and to educate the general public as to what a freethinker is.
My thoughts give me power.
No scholar can map them.
No hunter can trap them. No person can deny. Die Gedanken sind frei. No person can deny. Die Gedanken sind frei.
Hello, my name is Hugh Henry. This is Freethought Forum, and we have Mary Lou Thompson on today. We're going to be talking about Christianity versus humanity, or religion versus humanity. Mary Lou was born in Utah, in Salt Lake City. She is third generation from Sweden and second generation from Mormons. And our theme song talks about our thoughts freely flower, and Mary Lou, you are freely flowering today.
Yeah, clean up pretty good, don't I? Yeah.
That's your words. I didn't say that.
Well, usually I'm in shorts and a t-shirt. Anyway, and that's interesting, too, about flowers, you know. They don't give a dang about us, you know. It's purely reproduction with them, but we enjoy them anyway.
Well, there's some stuff that scientists have been discovering that plants have been very sneakily changing us while we've been changing plants.
Right.
They've been domesticating us while we've been domesticating them.
And one of the lines from Oscar Wilde's A Ballad of Reading Jail is really, really great. They won't let flowers grow in the prison yard because flowers have been known to heal a common man's despair.
Ooh.
Beautiful, what? Anyway, okay, now my idea is that the worst thing that has happened to humanity is religion. And that's all religions. I think Christianity is the worst of them, with Islam close behind. Of course, now they're going to put a fatwa on you? Anyway, the worst thing to happen to the planet Earth is the human race, but let's get back to the religion bit. Religion was originally invented by human beings to explain things they couldn't understand. Now we can explain most of them, but they won't give up their little beliefs, their superstitions. They cling to it like a baby with his little security blanket. And why can't that, like, we have our saying, you know, instead of getting born again, why don't they just grow up? And that would be nice. Now, the thing with fundamentalist Christians is they think because they want everybody to be like them, that atheists want everybody to be atheists. I admit it would be nice, but it's none of my business. If they want to believe in their superstitions, that's fine with me. Just don't shove it up on me.
Well, they're required by their religion to spread their religion and save souls. They're a proselytizing religion.
Save souls from what? My soul's fine. There's nothing threatening it, well, except them.
The funny thing is that the whole idea of the soul doesn't come from the Bible.
No, it doesn't, huh?
No, it comes from Greek philosophy that got crossbred with biblical Christianity.
Well, that's the thing. Christians think that they invented everything in their religion when they actually invented nothing at all except most of the idiotic parts, you know, about, you know, Jesus being the Son of God. And yet they trace his genealogy back through Joseph. Joseph wasn't his father. God supposedly was his father.
Yeah, but and that's a detail.
Well, yeah, right. And anyway, the thing is, it's all illogical, but they don't care. They like it. They enjoy it. That's fine with me. Just leave me out of it.
Well, they didn't even invent Jesus, Son of God, because you had all kinds of pagan sons of gods running around all over the place.
Oh, yeah.
And again, it's quite possible that the Son of God concept occurred as a mutation of Christianity, as the story of Jesus said, was spread because it spread through pagans and they simply adapted it.
Well, that's it. Christianity incorporated a lot of the pagan religious beliefs into the Christianity, so of course they could attract pagans to it. You know, dumb pagans, they should have stuck with what they had. Anyway, like Osiris, you know, the Egyptian god.
You mean the guy that got reborn?
That's it. He did Jesus a heck of a lot better. For one thing, after he was killed, his brother, Seth, cut him up in little pieces and scattered him all over the world. Well, his sister and future wife gathered him together, and, you know, then he came from the dead. I mean, Jesus, I mean, and as far as that goes, he wasn't on the cross long enough to die. He probably wasn't even dead yet.
Well, he was short one piece that was eaten by a fish that she couldn't recover.
And I know what one that was.
Yeah.
Why do you think the fish is a symbol for that, you know?
Yeah.
The old trouser trout.
They lost his penis, so they had a problem there.
Yeah. You know, they have all these euphemisms for, you know, penis, you know, like a trouser trout and a pulsing python and all that, you know. Oh, and also, did you know that men give their penises little personal names like My Willie or John or whatever? You know why they do that?
No, but maybe we should stick to Christianity versus humanity.
I just have to say it, though, because they don't like to be bossed around by a stranger.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. Now, because of religions, you know, not just Christianity, we've got the Middle East. We've got Northern Ireland. We've got Lebanon. We've got the people in Africa fighting each other. We've got, you know, kill the American Indians, because after all they've got is, and this is else too. You know, we have all these wars and things. You know, if you don't like my God, or if you hate my God, I'm going to kill you.
Well, look at all the peace that religion, particularly Christianity, has brought.
You're being silly.
Well, then there was, I guess I better forget it.
I will admit, there are a few things that religion has done that are nice. The art and architecture and some of the music. I still like Schubert's Ave Maria. Can't help it. And one of my favorite hymns was my grandfather's favorite hymn. He was a minister in the Episcopal Church. And it's a beautiful hymn. And some of the music is good. But some of it is just repetitious and all that.
Especially in the Episcopal Church. I know. I was one. God, they have awful music.
Oh, come on now. God of Our Fathers is a beautiful hymn.
And yeah, but then there's all the other stuff.
Well, you know, the Mormons have some good hymns, like Bringing in the Sheaves.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Baptists and Methodists have the best.
Yeah. Well, anyway, if we didn't have religion, we'd have a fairly peaceful world. We'd still have wars over territory. But we wouldn't justify them by saying, well, we're doing it because our God told us to. And Mark Twain has some great stuff that was only published after his death, because he knew what was going to happen, about, you know, how God is always on your side. You know, he's not on the other people's side. It may be the same God, but he's for you. And God really cares about that football game. He wants your side to win. I mean, if a God is interested in all that, can he really, really be keeping an eye on things like tsunamis, you know, and the plagues and all that?
Well, that's why the top of the stadium up in Dallas is open, is so God can see his team play.
Oh, man. And if you've heard that, haven't you? The Texas people say, well, if God isn't a longhorn, how come the sunset is burnt orange? Also, did you know that a longhorn, you know why a longhorn grows those great big long horns?
Why does a longhorn grow all those great lungs?
Because he's a steer. He's been castrated. A longhorn bull doesn't have horns that long because he's using the energy to make sperm and cover cows. Now, the longhorn cows, of course, do have long horns because they don't have all that testosterone.
Yeah, maybe we better get back to religion versus humanity.
Okay, besides the art and architecture, I can't think of anything the religion has done as good. People will say, what?
Science.
The Arabians, of course, kept alive a lot of the science during the Dark Ages.
But the Arabians didn't go to the moon. We did.
Not because we believed in God.
No, but because science grew out of Protestant Christianity. Because the Protestants didn't trust, of course, what the Catholic Church had done in anything that it had done. So they went back to the Bible, but they were nervous about...
But don't you think that we would have had science anyway without any of the religions?
Nobody else ever did. If you allow 1,000 years to go from zero to the moon, right? And you lay that 1,000 years on all kinds of different civilizations.
Well, you know, gunpowder was invented by the Chinese.
Yeah, but they didn't do science the way we did.
Yeah.
And then you look at the guys that actually went to the moon in 1000 AD, and these are the scruffiest, most illiterate, most ignorant, superstitious bunch you ever wanted to see, and they didn't even start doing anything for 400 years.
Ha! Yeah, okay. Well, okay, science, you think, okay. That's your opinion.
It was because they didn't trust the Catholic Church, and then they weren't too sure about the Bible, that they decided there was one thing they could trust, which was the creation. Especially after Newton comes along and lays out laws for the motion of the planets, when Newton and everybody else still believed in astrology and that the planets controlled destiny. That must mean everything must run according to rules, and you figure out the rules, you figured out God. And you've got no person between you and it. It's right there. It's not like you got to trust some copyist keeping something straight for several thousand years.
And that's another thing. Astrology was invented something like 3,000 years ago, and they are still basing it on the position of the stars at that time. They're not in that position now in relation to the Earth. So it's kind of silly, you know. And also someone pointed out that the influence of the planets on you when you're born. The obstetrician delivering you, his gravitational attraction has much more influence on you than any planet. You know, even the Earth, as far as that goes.
So I'm this way because of the gravity of a doctor or a nurse?
Well, also because, you know, the particular sperm that attacked your mother's egg.
Okay, let's get back to religion versus humanity.
Yeah, well, the thing is, these people have in their idea something that they want to force on other people. They want them to do something, say they don't want anybody to have an abortion, you know. So they put religious significance on that when really it's a power thing. And it's mainly a male chauvinist power thing. Keep them barefoot and pregnant, you know.
Well, part of this big argument we're having now between about the sanctity of marriage and so forth. In other religions, the priest is there, like Hindu religion or Shintoism, the priest is there as a good luck charm. Marriage is really none of his business.
Right, right.
But in the early Middle Ages, the church went into marriage big time for just one purpose, control.
Right, and also, you know why priests are supposed to not get married, remain celibate? It has nothing really to do with religion. The Catholic Church didn't want their priests having kids and bequeathing them a Catholic property.
I can understand that. They fought for years in the state versus religion issue to get their own bishops and their own pope appointed.
Yeah.
Because it used to be the king appointed his buddies to that position,
right,
and the church had nothing to say about it. So the last thing they wanted was inherited positions.
Right. The thing is, all these things are nobody else's business. Who I marry or live with or have sex with is my business, nobody else's. And they talk, oh, the Republicans are great with this. Oh, states' rights, states' rights. And of course, unless, of course, the state is doing something the Republicans don't like, like in the case of Terry Schiavo.
Is that like activist judges until they make the wrong decision?
Right, right. That's the trouble. The Republicans want the whole thing to be theirs. They don't want anybody to have any say in anything.
Well, they just set it up that way, so it is.
Anyway, back to religion.
Yes.
They use religion as an excuse for all sorts of things, for taking other people's land, like the Israelis. When the Israelis won the Six-Day War back in 1967, the year my daughter was born, I was proud of them. I thought it was great. And I remember a great cartoon, I think it was by Malden. It shows Nasser standing up there, you know, with hung in Russian weaponry, you know, and with his Arab headdress on. And Israel, as poor little David there with his slingshot. And Nasser saying, you're not going to fight back, are you? You know, and I thought that was great. But now they are just doing exactly the same thing as every other conqueror does. You know, they're, you know, killing and displacing the native peoples. Well, now, look what we did with the American Indian.
Well, let's stay on Israel for a minute. One of the problems with Israel is that their form of government, the way they do what they call proportional representation, you have a tail that wags the dog. So you have two large parties that can never really get large enough to control the Knesset. And then you have one major minority party that sits in the middle that says, all right, you're dancing to my tune if you want to run this country. And that party is Shatz, and Shatz is the religious party of Israel. Oh. So this minority party, you know, calls all the stuff for the other two, because if they want to form a coalition and get a prime minister, they got to deal with these people.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You were talking about the American Indian.
Oh, all right. This was neat. I saw a cartoon strip a long time ago, and this little girl comes home from first grade, and she said, Grandpa, we learned about the Native Americans today, about how they took care of the earth, and they thanked the animals for sacrificing themselves so they could have food and clothing, and they took care of their old people. And, you know, they were very careful with each other, and they worshiped their gods. She said, why do we call them savages? You know why you call them savages? Because if you demonize them, then you can kill them with no compunctions. It's okay with you, your God, so it's okay. And this is another thing. These Christians particularly are so arrogant. Every time something horrible happens, they say, oh, well, it's part of God's plan. We don't know his purposes, though Billy Graham and Bush seem to know his purposes.
Well, who was that lady that was glad that God saved her from the tsunami?
Oh,
she was on
this is another thing.
She was on vacation, and she got back before it hit.
Oh, jeez. This is another thing that got me This lady down in the Gulf on a shrimp boat fell off into the Gulf. Through her own initiative, persistence, and endurance, she saved herself. She thanks God for it. As long as she's going to thank God for saving her, why doesn't she blame God for pushing her off the shrimp boat in the first place? Since he's responsible for everything, well, then he's responsible for 9/11. He's responsible for tsunami. That's why they invented Satan, to blame, have someone to blame. And besides, if God is so powerful, why doesn't he just zap Satan? You know, boom, you're dead.
Well, and there's Pat Roberts speaking about the 9/11, saying that he blames the abortionists and the gays and the feminists, and that God was showing us that we were doing the wrong thing by killing 3,000 people.
Right. And that's another thing, you know. They say God has a plan, and we can't understand what he's doing, you know, what his plan is. How come they're always telling God they want to change? Hey, God, please, please, let us win this football game. God, save my son. God, this and that. And, you know, when my son was dying, you know, everybody was praying for him, except me and my husband and the people, in fact. You know, nothing fails like prayer. And if it was going to work, you know, at least he might have had a little relief instead of dying the horrible way he did, you know. But it didn't help. It helped the people who were praying. That's it. So
yes.
I don't want to deny them that. That is fine. But don't tell me. And when people, you know, when I do something nice for someone, they say, God bless you. I accept it. That's fine. They believe it. And I just realized, and I told this to one of my really good Christian friends, with all these people praying for me and all these people blessing me and all that, and I get a lot of it. You know, like when I give up one of the guys at the street corner a dollar. You know, when I get up to the pearly gates, he's going to say, well, we know you're an unbeliever, but so many good people are vouching for you and praying for you that we're going to let you in on a contingency basis.
Yeah, but that's not going to work.
Why not?
Nothing fails like prayer.
Well, no. But the thing is, they've been telling God how nice I am. See, I've got them all fooled. I have a friend in Los Angeles. Well, anyway, back to religion. God damn it. The thing is, people think I'm intelligent, and what it is really is I have a great memory, and I remember all these things, and so I go off on tangents this way and that. So, okay, like I say, it would be nice if everybody was atheist, but they're not. But now, this is a very petty thing. I cannot buy beer before noon on Sunday. How would they like it if we were in control? And we wouldn't do this because we're not that petty. And we said, okay, you can only buy Bibles on Saturday, and you can only go to church on Sunday, and that's it.
Well, if you want to buy beer on Sunday, then move to New York.
Well, I don't want to live in New York. I kind of like it. Well, besides, my husband wants to live in San Antonio. You know, and he's the boss. He claims I'm the boss. If I was the boss, we'd be living in Montana, at least, maybe Canada. Also, he says,
or at least Montana, so if things get really bad, you don't have a short. It's only a short hop to get out of here.
Yeah.
Well, now wait a minute. We have all these problems because of Christians being dominating in this country, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
If it were an atheist country, we would have all the problems of an atheist country. When you're in charge, you're also in charge of all the things that are wrong.
I know, but we wouldn't justify it by some superstition. We try to find some logical explanation for it.
Okay, so you don't mind the problems, it's just the justification that makes your teeth itch.
Right. Can your teeth itch? I don't think they have any nerves for that.
They may not, but there's some things that these people do that make my teeth itch.
That puts my teeth on edge. I'd like to bite a few of them. Take a good bite, you know. See if you know, they are so silly, too, you know, because God mandated that this earth is for them. The environment, you know, and so many of them think, well, it doesn't matter if we destroy the environment because, you know, in a few years we're going to have the rapture and we're all going to heaven anyway, except for the millions of people who don't know God. You know, the Mormon church, they baptize for the dead. You know, if your ancestors, you know, weren't baptized while they're like you baptized. When I was a teenager, I thought, you know, if I'm rich, I'm going to leave $1,000 to the Mormon church if they promise not to baptize me after I'm dead. You know, they took over. I'm going down the street there in Salt Lake City, and I go to turn right on Main Street. There isn't any Main Street there anymore. They cut it off and incorporated it into the temple grounds. And a lot of good Mormons in Salt Lake City were mad about that, too. And another thing, that beautiful temple, and it is beautiful.
Yes, it is.
I used to sit upon the hillside and look at it before the air pollution. You can't even see it now because of all these huge buildings around. And I said to my cousin, I know who's a very good Mormon, it's rather sad when greed and avarice trump faith and beauty. And she agreed with me. you know, but that's it. Money is it. Like the PGA village, money is it. Anybody remember King Midas? Everything turned to gold. He couldn't eat, he couldn't drink. He was praying, begging, please, please take away the golden touch.
Well, apparently our American God comes in denominations of 1s, 5s, 10s, 50s, 100s, and 500s.
And also, have you ever noticed that Christians do not even seem to be able to read their own Bible? You know, none of them seem
to
remember.
I've been talking about that for months on this program, and will continue.
They don't seem to have read the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus said, do not stand in the synagogue and pray like in public like the hypocrites do. Go into your closet and shut the door and pray to your God in secret.
Oh, you mean
Bush
like
doesn't
the,
do that.
Oh, you mean like the National Day of Prayer on the courthouse steps?
Oh, yeah. Can you imagine this lady telling us to move to the back of the crowd? I mean, it's not quite as bad as blacks and Hispanics, but that's discrimination right there. And when I said, well, would you like to live in a theocracy where they cut off your hand if you steal? They stone a woman to death for adultery and give her co-adulterer a smack on the wrist? Well, she said, why don't you go there? I said, well, I love this country. I don't want to go there. She could not believe that I love this country because I didn't love her stupid God. Ah!
They can believe a lot of things, but they can't believe that.
And there's Garza. Garza, whom he came and spoke to our group. He's another hypocritical liar. He says, he's up there on the steps of City Hall participating in this day, and you can't tell me that that fancy sound system and all wasn't paid for by taxpayer money. And I think it was rather neat when the Pope came to visit. Taxpayer funds were filled on this big, huge, elaborate display for the Pope to stand and speak. The wind blew it down. So apparently God really didn't want the Pope to speak in San Antonio. And that was another thing. Here God obviously wanted the Pope dead. He's trying to kill him. And here they are fighting it as hard as they can. You know, all sorts of unnatural methods when you're only supposed to use natural methods like, say, in birth control. You know what they call people who use the rhythm method of birth control?
Well, they call people who use the rhythm method of birth control.
Parents.
Okay.
Oh.
Well, let's get back to the Native Americans you were talking about. The head of the U.S. Army, whose name escapes me at the moment, said that when dealing with the Indian, no question of American honor can ever arise.
Right.
By which he meant that we had no need to honor any treaty.
Right, right, right.
Because we don't have to honor anything with them.
I always wondered, what do they mean by Indian giver? You know, I couldn't understand. I never heard of that.
That means you gave it to
yes,
the Indians
well,
and took it back.
Yeah, that's. I didn't know that. But it dawned on me. Here I am up in Montana at a faculty wives meeting. And it dawned on me what it was. I said, oh, I know what that means. It means give to the Indian and then take it back. And you could feel the hostility just descend on me. They hate Indians up there, of course, because they feel guilty for taking their land. that's something, too. The Native Americans, can't remember which tribes, they did not persecute their homosexuals or their cross-dressers or whatever. They considered them favorites of the gods because they were different. And they treated them nice. They took care of them. They took care of them and, gave them special privileges because they were unique. They were something different. They're not us. Boy, we're going to kill them because they chose. Can you imagine choosing a lifestyle that the whole country, most of the country, hates and wants to kill and does kill, like Matthew Shepard? You don't choose that. They don't choose to be homosexual any more than I chose to be straight. Well, I enjoy it. You know, it's an accepted thing now. It's not accepted being an atheist. Oh, yeah, the Hispanics wanted Gonzalez, you know, to be confirmed as attorney general. You know, a sycophant. Just because he was Hispanic. They said, oh, we're underrepresented at the highest levels of government. Well, hey, us atheists are not represented at all at any level of government. You know, and they're not going to let us. The Constitution says there shall be no religious test for office, but by darn there is.
And that's in the Constitution outside the Bill of Rights, which means it was the only thing put in about religion before the Bill of Rights. Yeah. It's the one thing they wanted to nail down for certain.
And I was talking to someone in archaeology, and he claimed that it says in the Constitution that it mentions God. It doesn't. There's no mention of God in the Constitution, none at all. This guy hadn't even read his Constitution, let alone his Bible. It also advocates abortion in the Bible. When God tells the Israelites to go, you know, they're always killing somebody.
Yep.
You know, when he goes, they're fighting these people, and he tells them, you know, rip up the pregnant women. You know, it's rather drastic. Kills a woman, too. You know, but that is obviously abortion. You kill a woman, so what? You can get another brood sow. Just like the wife of that woman who drowned her five children. I mean, the husband of the woman who drowned those five children. He was the one that should have been prosecuted. And to not allow her an insanity plea. Any mother who kills her kids is insane. And, I was on the verge, you know, of whacking them a couple of times, but I never wanted to kill them.
I don't know. Some of them can drive you insane, can't they?
Oh, did you know that insanity is inherited? That's just it. You get it from your kids. Well, your grandkids.
I thought grandparents were immune from that effect.
Oh, no. I was already halfway there anyway. and the second grandchild, Rory, he just lately has become civilized. Oh, he's going to be a scientist. When he got stung by what he called a wasp, he was more interested, after the initial scream, he was more interested in how its wings were and its legs and things like that than he was, you know, in having been hurt.
That's a scientist.
Yeah. And he also asked his mother one time, you know, when she was pregnant with a little girl. We didn't know she was a girl then. How does the baby get out? He had been kissing this baby through her stomach. He loved this baby already. And he said, does it come out your mouth? And she said, no, it comes out down below. He said, does it come out your penis? She says, no, I don't have one. He said, well, does it come out your testicles? She says, I don't have testicles. He said, well, what do you have? And she said, she didn't want to go into the details. She said, I have female private parts.
Getting back to religion versus humanity.
That's another thing. My daughter she fell in love, became a Catholic. And when I watched my poor little two-year-old grandson trying to make the sign of the cross when they were saying grace and waving his hand around, I thought, oh, my Lord. And see, people will say, well, it's none of your business. They're her kids. They're my grandkids, and she's my child, and I don't like to see her turn into an ass-wiping, vomit-cleaning up, baby-making machine.
Well, you know, when you do the sign of the cross, you've got to realize the terrible difference in Russia in particular.
Yeah.
Between...
You go this way, one you go that way, and...
No, wait a minute. Between this and this. Did you catch that?
I didn't get it at all, and I really don't care.
This and this. Between two fingers and a thumb and three fingers and a thumb, as far as the old Russians, the Dukhobors, the ones that take their clothes off and burn their houses down up in Canada, three fingers and a thumb is papist. It's Catholic. The only, because it's Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. The only legitimate one, Holy Ghost has to be your thumb.
My grandfather was an Episcopal minister. He had a master's degree in theology from Brown University. He hated Catholics. Mormons were okay, but he didn't like Catholics. He also cut the Apocrypha out of his Bible because he really didn't think it was part of the Bible. Everybody has their own opinions. They're entitled to them. I just don't like the restrictions put on me. I remember when we came back through, of course, this isn't, they claim it's religious. Came back through West Texas on the way to San Antonio on vacation. Boy, the next town we come to, we're going to have a beer. Dry all the way, you know, right? Well, of course, they have these little private clubs. If you give them money, you can get in and get your beer.
Well, we've gone about as far as we can go with religion and versus humanity, or at least as far as we can go staying on the track as we could.
We didn't stay much on the track.
This is Hugh Henry for Freethought Forum saying thank you for tuning in and listening to us, and please tune in again. Thank you very much.
I think as I please, and this gives me pleasure.
My conscience decrees, this right I must treasure.
My thoughts will not cater
to duke or dictator. No person can deny